Good morning, everyone. In the previous session of Management of Financial Services, I explained about the last topic of the first unit, that is the last capital market instrument, bonds. So in the last session, I explained what is bond, what are the various types of bonds, what are the advantages and disadvantages of issue of bonds. So in the previous session itself, the last first unit was completed. So in this session, I am going to begin the second unit. First of all, I am going to explain in brief what are the various topics that you're going to study in the second unit. And then I am going to start with the first topic of the second unit, that is capital structure decision. Okay. So as you all can see on the screen, these are the topics that you are going to study under the second unit. The first one is capital structure decision. First of all, in this topic, I will explain what is capital structure, how the decision regarding capital structure takes place, or how the organization takes decision regarding formation of capital structure, what are the factors which influence the decision regarding capital structure. So that we are going to study in the second unit, the first topic of the second unit. And the second topic is new issue market. New issue market simply means whenever an instrument is issued for the first time, it is the part of the primary market. It is issued in the new issue market. So I am going to explain what are the functions of new issue market, what are the various other aspects of new issue market. Then we are going to study the four important methods of issue in the new issue market, that is IPO, that is initial public offering, then private placement, public issues, right issues. So these are the various forms of issuing shares in the market. Okay. So what is the basic procedure of issuing these type of four instruments, that I'm going to explain. Then I'm going to explain what are the SEBI rules and regulations of regarding these four aspects, that is public issue, right issue, private placement and IPO. So SEBI has created certain rules and regulation for each and every aspect, so that we are going to study. And then at last, I'm going to explain the prospectus, how a prospectus is created and everything. So this is the portion that you all are going to study in the second unit. Okay. So let's begin the session with the first topic of second unit, that is capital structure decision. So first of all, capital structure means arrangement of finance from various resources in order to meet the long-term requirements of funds. So capital structure basically means whenever an organization starts operating, they have to get finance from various sources. And these finances are required for the purpose of, for the long-term purpose. Means more than 5 years or 5 years or 10 years, they need finance for that many years. So they are supposed to pay the amount of money after those 5 years or 10 years only. So that that kind of finance comes under long-term funds. So in order to use various resources to raise long-term finance, that is the most important part of capital structure. So capital structure basically means the arrangement of finance, means which source, which resource is supposed to be used to raise long-term finance, and in what proportion it should be used. So that is capital structure. So basically it is the combination of equity shares, preference shares, long-term loans, debentures, retained earnings, and there are various other aspects also which come under capital structure. So these are the various sources of long-term finance. Okay. Now the capital structure actually refers to the proportion of these finance, how much a percentage of capital will be raised from the equities or preference share or debenture. That proportion needs to be decided. That is called capital structure decision. Okay. So after, for example, an organization has used only 20% of capital, or they have raised 20% of capital by issuing debenture. So they will decide the debt equity ratio. How much amount of fund is to be raised through equities, or how much amount of fund is to be raised by the debentures or loan form. So that debt equity ratio needs to be decided. So that is the capital structure decision. Okay. Now, this capital structure decision plays a very important part in every organization, okay? Because the sources through which the organization or the company raises funds, it actually has great impact on its operations, has great impacts on the efficiency of the organization, how an organization effectively performs, and it also has risk element related to the risk element involved in the return on equity owners. So first of all, if the organization is completely financed through equity shares, so that may increase the risk of the equity owners. So the decision regarding capital structure has impact on the equity, equity shareholders, has impact on the entire organization, its operations and effectiveness. And because it impacts the entire organization, the decision regarding capital structure is very important for every organization. They need to decide what should be the debt equity ratio, what should be the proportion of debt and equity in order to have a successful business, in order to satisfy the stakeholders of the organization. So from this point of view, capital structure decision is very crucial for every organization. Okay, there is another term that is financial structure, and people get confused between capital structure and financial structure. So financial structure is about the financial structure of the entire organization, which includes long-term as well as short-term funds. So it includes all the sources through which the long-term finance, the long-term funds will be raised, as well as all the sources through which short-term funds will be raised. But capital structure is all about the long-term sources of finance. It is the permanent finance of the organization, the sources through which long-term finances will be raised. So that is the basic difference between financial structure and capital structure. Okay. Now, these are the pattern of capital structure, how an organization decides to have a capital structure. So the first one is equity shares only. Any, for example, an organization decides to raise all the funds through equity shares only. They are supposed to issue equity shares and they are going to raise the funds for the entire amount of capital from the equity shares only. So that choice depends upon the size of the organization, the creditworthiness of the organization, the reputation, what kind of nature, what is the nature of the business. So it this decision depends upon various factors. So an organization can actually have a capital structure including only equity shares. That decision depends upon the organization itself. Okay. Now, the another pattern is combination of both equity and preference shares. Now, they need to decide the proportion of equity and preference shares. What should be the proportion of equity? Whether they are going to raise large amount of major proportion of capital from equity share or large portion of capital from preference share. That decision needs to be taken. Then, the third one is equity shares and debenture. They can mix. They can have a capital mix having both equity shares and debentures. Here also they need to decide the proportion of equity shares as well as the debenture, whether they are going to finance the major portion of capital from debenture or equity share. What needs to be the ratio? What is the ratio of the capital structure, the debt equity ratio? That needs to be decided. And the last one is equity shares, preference shares and debentures. An organization can issue all these three types of shares and debentures in order to raise finance for capital. They can issue equity shares, they can issue preference shares, and they can at the same time issue debentures. So they can get the advantage of each and every source of finance. So here also they need to decide the proportion of debenture, preference share and equity. So these are the some of the basic patterns of capital structure. So any organization can choose any structure of any capital structure depending upon their requirement, depending upon their size of the business, the nature of the business and other elements of the business. So these are the basic four patterns of capital structure. Okay, so now I'm going to explain the kind of capital structure. There are around four kinds of capital structure. First one is horizontal, vertical, pyramid shaped capital structure, and the last one is inverted pyramid shaped capital structure. So a capital structure can be in these types of forms. Okay, so the first one is horizontal capital structure. So the first kind of capital structure, like I said, horizontal capital structure, first of all, it does not have any kind of debt in the capital structure mix. So here the capital structure consists of only equity shares and retained earnings. Retained earnings means every organization earns a certain amount of profit, and it is up to the organization how much amount of profit they are supposed to keep back with the organization for future requirements. So that is the decision of the organization. So that is called retained earnings. Then equity shares. Equity shares means the organization can issue equity shares to the general public, and whoever is interested in investing in the company, they will purchase the equity share and they will become the real owners of the company. So how they issue equity share, what form they select in order of issuing equity share, that depends upon the organization. So basically here means the owners of the equity share, the holders of the equity shares are the real owners of the organization. They have voting rights, they have means they can take part in the important decision making process of the management. Okay, so here in horizontal capital structure, it consists of only equity shares and retained earnings. It does not consist debt in the capital structure mix. Now another important here element is that because it does not consist of debentures, it cannot take advantage of financial leverage. Because of absence of debenture, it lacks financial leverage. So what is financial leverage? Here it means that with the proper debt structure, they can have more amount, more kinds of or more assets by showing the debentures to the public or to the people who wants to invest in the organization. Okay, so financial leverage is also termed as trading on equity. So it simply here means that when an organization uses debt financing in order to attain any type of asset, so whatever profit they gain from the asset is actually increases the dividends of the equity shareholders. So that is called trading on equity. They will attain a large amount or various types of assets by debt financing, but the ultimate benefit from the assets will be given to the equity shareholders. And this is only possible if the capital structure has a combination of debt and equity. With only equity and retained earnings, this financial leverage, this trading on equity, the advantages of trading on equity cannot be obtained, cannot be provided to the shareholders of equity shares, or we can say the real owners of the organization. So the benefit of the financial leverage, the benefit of the trading on equity is actually obtained by the real owners of the organization if debt financing is involved in the capital structure. If not, this kind of advantage cannot be obtained by the real owners of the organization. So this is horizontal capital structure. It has zero debt component. It does not have any kind of debt in the capital structure mix. And it consists of only equity shares and retained earnings, and due to which there is an absence of financial leverage, there is a lack of financial leverage. Okay, and the next kind of capital structure is vertical capital structure. Okay, here vertical here simply means that first of all, whenever an organization, whenever a business starts, they have to put certain amount of money. The owner of the organization need to put certain amount of money or certain amount of capital into the organization. So here it says that the base of the capital structure is formed by equity shares. So some amount of equity shares will be issued so that the foundation of the organization can be created on the basis of equity share. But the major financing is done by the debt financing form. So basically, first of all, certain amount of capital will be raised through equity share to create a strong foundation. And then additional finance can be obtained from the from the form of debt, from the various forms of debt. So that is the structure of vertical capital structure. Clear? So after creating a strong base of equity shares, the organization can take decision regarding issue of preference shares and other debt financing. So the portion of equity share, the proportion of equity shares or equity capital is very less in comparison to preference share capital and debt financing. It involves a large amount of preference share capital and debt financing. So that is vertical capital structure. Okay. The next one is pyramid shaped capital structure. So first of all, what is the shape of a pyramid? It looks like a triangle. So here we can say that the base of the organization has large proportion, has contribution to the capital structure in a large proportion. And that contribution is done by equity shares and retained earnings. So when pyramid shaped capital structure is created, major contribution to the capital is done through equity shares and retained earnings. And because it is also mentioned that the cost of share capital and retained earnings are lower than the debt. So obviously retained earnings means whatever profit the organization has earned, they can put it back into the organization. It involves a very low cost. And share capital also involves a very low cost in comparison to the debt financing source. So that's why larger portion of the capital is contributed through equity shares and retained earnings. So the organization which uses this kind of capital structure, they are very risk averse. They avoid taking risk because this is, like I said, the cost involved in issue of shares and the cost involved in the retained earning aspect is very low in comparison to the cost of debt. So they do not want to take more and more amount of risk. So risk is very low. And because of that, the business remains stable for a very long time period. So because of this reason, many organizations go for this kind of structure, who do not want to take risk, who do not want to have any unstable kind of business. So that's why they go for more proportion of share capital and retained earnings and very low proportion of debt. I'm not saying that there is no debt at all. There is debt. But if you compare the proportion, the size of share capital and the size of debt financing, the size of share capital is huge in comparison to the debt financing. And one of the major reason is the risk element. And another reason is the cost of issuing shares and cost of raising debt financing. So because the cost of issuing shares and retained earnings is very less, and the organization prefers to avoid risk, to become risk averse, they go for this type of capital structure. The larger portion of capital is contributed by share capital and retained earnings, and a low proportion of debt is involved in the capital structure. Okay, so this is the third type of capital structure. And the last one is inverted pyramid shaped capital structure. Inverted means the opposite one. So it is simply the opposite of pyramid shaped capital, where the share capital and retained earnings has major contribution. But here in the inverted pyramid shaped capital structure, the debt financing has the major contribution. Higher proportion of debt financing is used in this capital structure, and very small proportion of equity capital and retained earnings is used in this type of capital structure. Okay, so in this type of capital structure, usually large organization who wants to grow and expand, they have this kind of capital structure. Even if it involves a large amount of risk, but these type of organization are open to risk because it will give them various opportunities for increasing their profit, for expansion and growth. So many organization, large organization go for this type of capital structure. Okay, so these are the four kinds of capital structure, and organization can select any kind of capital structure depending upon their business, depending upon the degree of risk they want to get involved in the business and all those aspects. Okay, and next topic which I am going to discuss today is the ideal capital structure, means what kind of benefits a capital structure must provide, a capital structure which will be suitable for all the kinds of business. What is the ideal capital structure? Okay, and the first point it says that it should minimize the cost of capital, which means whatever may be the proportion of debt and equity, it must lead to minimization of cost of capital. Cost of capital means cost involved in raising capital, in raising the source of finance or raising money for the organization in the form of capital. That cost needs to be very low. So whether an organization goes for equity capital or debt financing or any other form, it must have one important element in that it must lead to minimize the cost of capital. So the ideal capital structure must provide or must minimize the cost of capital. Okay, the next one is it should reduce risk. See, risk is always involved in the business because it is affected by an organization, is affected by various elements, internal, external, and other elements also. So risk amount is very high whenever an organization go for a complete debt financing aspect. So there are risks. So whatever may be the capital structure, it must overall reduce some kind of risk. So the level of risk must be low regarding the capital structure. So whenever a decision regarding capital structure is taken, they must analyze the level, the degree of risk involved in that type of capital structure. So whatever may be the proportion of debt or equity, it must lead to reduction of risk. Okay, the next one is it should give required flexibility. See, capital structure cannot be rigid because it needs to make certain changes depending upon the external factors, depending upon various other elements. So if an organization makes a very rigid capital structure which is not flexible, the organization would face various kinds of problems in future. So whatever may be the capital structure, it must be very flexible. Like if the organization has started the business with equity funds only, with equity equity shares only, there must be some chance that in future they can raise finance through debt also. So that kind of opportunity and capital structure must have. So a capital structure needs to be created in such a way that it is flexible. Any source of finance can be used for raising capital. So if the capital structure is rigid, they will stick to only one source of finance, which will make organization very rigid, less amount of profit will be earned by the organization and it won't grow and expand. So it needs to be very flexible. So whatever may be the composition of the capital mix, it must be flexible. The next one is it should provide required control to the owners. So like you all know that the equity shareholders are the real owners of the organization. It must give proper control to them because management would take a decision depending upon various aspects. Owners have different point of view, but owners wants the business to become more and more successful so that their earnings can increase. So their point of view would be very important for the growth and expansion of the organization. So the capital structure needs to be created in such a way that it would provide proper control to the owners. Okay, the owners needs to be involved in the decision making process. They must have a control over the business. Next one is it should enable the company to have an adequate finance. So whatever may be the structure, it must be capable of providing proper finance to the organization. It does not mean that we are using various sources of finance, but the total amount of finance which we have raised is never sufficient. So whatever may be the debt equity ratio, whatever may be the source of finance, it must be enough for the organization. They must raise adequate amount of finance for the business, for the operations of the business. Okay. And the last one is, it should maximize the value of the firm. The overall value of the firm needs to be maximized, and that this element also depends upon the capital structure. In what way they have raised finance, what are the various sources of finance. So too much of debt financing will lead to more involvement of risk. Only equity financing will lead to too much control of the owners. So in order to increase the value of the firm, they need to have a proper combination and proper combination of debt and equity. So whatever may be the capital structure, it must provide all the things that are mentioned in the ideal capital structure. That is the basic objective of a capital structure. Okay. So in this session, I have explained about capital structure. What are the various patterns? What are the kinds of capital structure? And then I explained about the ideal capital structure. In the next session, I'm going to explain the basic principles of capital structure and what are the basic factors, what are the important factors which influence the capital structure decision. Okay, so that's it for today. We will meet in the next session. Thank you.